Hello students, we are again here in the video lecture series designed for you. In our last two lectures, we were discussing the meaning of national income at constant prices and national income at current prices, gross domestic production at market price, at factor cost and much more. Today we will discuss some more concepts related to national income. As we discussed earlier, production and sale of goods and services generates income. This income gives rise to demand for goods and services, and demand in turn gives rise to expenditure. Again, expenditure leads to further production. The circular flow of production, income, expenditure represents three related phases, namely production, distribution, and disposition. These three phases look at national income in three ways: as a flow of goods and services, as a flow of income, and as a flow of expenditure on goods and services. For each phase, we need different data, we need different methods, because if we want to measure it at the phase of production, we have to find out the sum of net value added by all the producing enterprises of the country. If we want to measure it at the phase of income, we have to find out the total income generated in the production of goods and services. Finally, if we want to measure it at the phase of disposition, we have to know the sum of expenditure of the three spending units in the economy, namely government, consumer household, and producing enterprises. According to these three phases, there are three methods of measuring national income, and they are value added method, also known as product method, income method, and expenditure method. Let's discuss first the value added method. This method measures the contribution of each producing enterprise in the domestic territory of the country. This method involves the following steps in measurement of national income. Firstly, identifying the producing enterprise and classifying them into industrial sectors according to their activities. That is, first is identification and classification. Secondly, estimating net value added by each producing enterprise as well as industrial sector, and adding up the net value added by all these sectors. That is, second is estimation. All the producing enterprises are broadly classified into three main sectors, namely primary sector, which includes agriculture and related activities, secondary sector, which includes manufacturing units, and tertiary sector, which includes services like banking, insurance, transport, communication, trade and professions. The production units are classified by Central Statistics Officer CSO into 14 distinct industrial sectors. That is, Central Statistics Officer has classified all the industrial sectors into 14 different categories. And these categories are, first, agriculture and allied activities, second, forestry and logging, third, fishing, fourth, mining and quarrying, fifth, registered manufacturing, sixth, unregistered manufacturing, seventh, construction, eighth, electricity, gas and water supply, ninth, trade, hotels and restaurants, tenth, transport, storage and communication, 11th, banking and insurance, 12th, real estate, ownership of dwellings and business services, 13th, public administration and defense, and 14th is other service category. These all 14 sectors are further divided into subsectors, and each subsector is further divided into commodity group or service group. For calculating the net product of the industrial sector, we subtract from the value of its gross output the value of the raw material and intermediate goods and services used by it, and from this we subtract the amount of depreciation. For the economy as a whole, we add net products contributed by each sector to get net domestic product. care should be taken to include the value of the following items. That is, own account production of fixed assets by government, enterprises and households. Second, care should be taken for production for self-consumption, that is, which is not sold. Third, imputed rent of owner-occupied houses. Production for self-consumption means the producers themselves consume the entire output which they produced. And a subsistence production unit is one which is able to produce only that much which is just sufficient to meet his family needs. And an economy which is dominated by subsistence production unit is called a subsistence economy. Care should also be taken not to include sale of second-hand machines because they were counted as a part of production in the year in which they were produced. However, brokerage and commission earned by the dealers of second-hand goods are a part of the production and hence included while calculating total value added. There is a difference of opinion among the national income accountants regarding raw material, intermediate goods and depreciation. For example, a question arises whether government services are final or intermediate. In India, we treat them as final service, but in Soviet Union, these are treated as intermediate services. Similarly, it is very difficult to ascertain the actual amount of depreciation because a fall in the value of capital stock depends upon many factors which are difficult to measure. Moreover, large areas of production activities are excluded for various reasons because there is no acceptable way of valuing them. For example, services of housewives or self-service in homes or services of friends. Sometimes, net value added of many producing units cannot be measured due to difficulty of securing data of the subsistence producing units, particularly in underdeveloped countries. Subsistence production again means production for self-consumption. Therefore, we can say that this method, value-added method, gives information about the industrial origins of national income. But remember, net income from abroad should also be taken into account to get true picture of national income. We used the term depreciation somewhere. Let's understand its meaning. Actually, depreciation is an annual allowance for wear and tear of a capital good. In other words, it is the cost of the good divided by number of years of its useful life. For example, consider a new machine that a firm invests in. This machine may be in service for next 20 years, after which it needs to be replaced. We can now imagine that each year, 1/20th of its original value is getting depreciated. So, instead of considering a bulk investment for replacement after 20 years, we consider an annual depreciation cost every year. Actually, depreciation is an accounting concept. It is a non-cash expense yet is accounted for annually. This was product method. Now, income method. Different factors of production merge their services for carrying out production activities. These factors of production in return are paid for their services in the form of factor incomes. Thus, labor gets wages, land gets rent, capital gets interest and entrepreneur gets profit. In other words, whatever is produced by a producing unit is distributed among the factors of production for their services. And aggregates of factor incomes of all the factors of production of all the producing units of the economy form the subject matter of calculation of national income. Only incomes earned by owners of primary factors of production are included in national income. Remember, transfer incomes are excluded from national income. Thus, while wages of laborers will be included, pensions of retired workers will be excluded from national income. Labor income includes, apart from wages and salaries, bonus, commission, employer's contribution to provident fund, and compensation in kind. Non-labor income includes dividends, undistributed profits of corporation before taxes, interest, rent, royalties, and profits of unincorporated enterprises and government enterprises. Sometimes it is difficult to separate labor income from capital income, because in many cases, people provide both labor and capital services. Such cases happen with the self-employed persons like lawyers, engineers, traders, etc. They themselves are labor and they provide capital. In order to overcome this difficulty, a new category of income called mixed income is introduced, which includes all those incomes which are difficult to separate. Remember that net income from abroad need not be added separately, since the income received by people include net foreign incomes as well. This was income method. Now, the last method of measuring national income is expenditure method. Expenditure method is an alternative way to calculate the national income by looking at the demand side of the product. The persons spend their incomes on consumer goods and services, or save a part of their incomes, or we can say that they spend a part of their income on non-consumption goods or capital goods. In this method, we add the final expenditures that each firm makes. Total expenditure in an economy consists of expenditure on financial assets, on goods produced in preceding periods, on raw materials and intermediate goods and services, and on final goods and services produced in the current period. Expenditure on financial assets which are produced and owned within the country is excluded, but expenditure on financial assets of foreign countries is included in national expenditure. However, only the net expenditure, that is difference between expenditure on foreign financial assets by residents and expenditure on the country's financial assets by non-residents or foreigners, is incorporated. This difference is also called net foreign investment. Goods produced in a preceding year are also excluded from national income, because they have been accounted for in the national incomes of the periods when they were produced. Similarly, expenditure on raw material and intermediate goods and services are excluded, because otherwise there will be double counting of some of the items included in the national income. Government expenditure on pensions, scholarships, unemployment, allowance, etc. should be excluded, because these all are transfer payments, not factor payment or factor income. Thus, we can conclude that only expenditure on final goods and services produced in the period for which national income is to be measured and net foreign investment are included in the expenditure method. Expenditure on final goods and services is broadly classified into expenditure on consumer goods and service, also called consumption expenditure, and expenditure on capital goods, also called investment expenditure. Consumption expenditure is further classified into private consumption expenditure of the household sector and government consumption expenditure. In the same way, investment expenditure is also classified into private investment expenditure by business sector and investment expenditure by government. We can write it as expenditure on final goods and services is equal to consumption expenditure plus investment expenditure. Consumption expenditure equals to private consumption expenditure plus government consumption expenditure. In the same way, investment expenditure is equals to private investment expenditure plus investment expenditure by government. So, this was the third method of measuring national income. Actually, there are a number of factors which determine the size of national income in a country. It is due to these factors that one country may have a larger national income than another. There are three main factors. First, quantity and quality of factors of production available in the country, like the quality of labor depending on inborn intelligence, education and training, influences the volume of industrial production. Also, the quantity of labor has a double influence since labor is at the same time both a factor of production as well as the consumer of what is produced. In the same way, capital may comprise simple, primitive tools or the most modern type of industrial equipment. The second factor affecting the volume of national income is the state of technical know-how present in the country, that is, state of technology available in the country. A country with poor technical knowledge cannot have a large size national income because it will not be in a position to make the best possible use of resources. The third factor affecting the volume of national income is political stability. Rather, it should be said that it is a prerequisite for maintaining production at the highest level. The economic development of several countries, particularly the South American republics, has been hindered in the past by political instability. It all was about the factors which influence the volume of national income. So, students, today we are closing here. We did the three methods of measuring national income today, and these were value added method, income method, and expenditure method. In our next lecture, we will do the remaining topics of national income. Till then, thank you.